Welcome back, students. So today we'll be studying about the DNA replication. In the last video, I had talked about DNA, its molecular structure and composition. Now coming to the DNA replication. DNA replication. All right. So, in the last video, I had discussed about Watson and Crick, who gave the molecular structure of DNA. Alright, the same scientists, Watson and Crick, after giving the molecular structure of DNA, proposed a scheme about the copying mechanism of DNA. What does it mean? It means that DNA, the parent molecule of DNA, has two strands, as I have already discussed. These two strands get separated, okay, and they produces the two daughter DNA. That means, for example, if this is a parent DNA, okay, to produce the two daughter DNA, we have to separate the two strands so that each strand acts as a template and produces its identical replicas. So how does it possible? I'll show through the figure that if this is a parent DNA, then we'll be separating these parent strands, and then each strand will act as a template and produces the identical replicas. All right. This is the second DNA that is being produced. Okay. This is the parent DNA. Parent DNA, all right. The two strands of DNA are being separated. That means the strands are separated, right? For example, if in the parent DNA, as I told you that in each turn there are 10 base pairs present inside one turn. This turn AT, CG, like this, 10 base pairs will be there. Alright, but here to separate the two strands of DNA, we have to break these bonds. The bonds, the hydrogen bonds A and T with double bond, and C and G are having the triple bond. We have to break these bonds and separate the two strands by which each strand of the parent DNA will act as a template and form a new synthesized DNA. So, we'll be separating the bonds. Now, if they were together in the parent DNA, we have separated them. Alright. And produced the two daughter DNAs. Again like this. The normal DNA. 10 base pairs again. Alright. This is how the DNA replication takes place. Simply, we can say that the parent DNA, the two strands of parent DNA will get separated and they produce their replicas. Each strand acts as a template and produces a new DNA. All right. This is what is known as a DNA replication. All right. Here we have 1 and 2, 2
daughter
DNA. Alright, this is the result of DNA replication. Now comes about the proteins and enzymes that are involved to separate these two strands and in producing the new strands for the polymerization of the chain. Alright, polymerization, the adding of new nucleotides. As I have told you, this backbone is made up of the nucleotides, isn't it? So, to make the new two daughter cells, two daughter DNA, what do we have to do? The polymerization of DNA chain, isn't it? Adding of new nucleotides. So, to add those nucleotides, to separate the two strands, we have number of proteins, number of enzymes, and we are going to study about all these in this video. Alright? So, there are three steps that are involved in the DNA replication. That is, the three steps are there involved in DNA replication. First is initiation. Second is elongation. Third is termination. Alright, so in this video, I'll be particularly talking about the initiation of DNA replication. As I have told you that the DNA replication is a semi-conservative replication. Until now, we were discussing about it. So, who gave that experimental proof about the semi-conservative replication? That was a scientist called Michelson and Stell. Michelson and Stell did an experiment on E. coli, that is a prokaryotic cell, and hence proved that the DNA is a semi-conservative replication. So, to know the detailed explanation about the experiment, please go through my video on the same. Alright, and please subscribe my channel so that whenever I upload a new video, you can get the notification about it. Now, coming to the initiation of DNA replication. Elongation and termination part I'll be taking in the another video. So, initiation of DNA replication. There are specific locations that are present in the DNA where the origin of replication happens. Alright. For example, if this is a DNA, alright, in E. coli, always there is a circular DNA. In E. coli, prokaryotic cell, there is a circular DNA. Mostly we find the linear DNAs, the linear ones. Alright. Circular means, linear doesn't mean like this. Linear means like this. They are of course coiled with each other. But circular means there is no way out. The circular DNA. Okay. In E. coli. Alright. So, it is all compact. In E. coli, the DNA, the genetic material is in a compact manner. Okay. And if we see the origin of replication, alright, it can start anywhere, maybe here. Alright, for example, if the DNA replication starts here, we will term it as ORIC. ORIC means the origin of replication, from where the replication starts. Alright, the specific locations from where the beginning of replication happens. So, There is one. Now I'll be telling you about the enzymes and proteins that will start the procedure. Okay. So for example, okay, this is OIC, right? If I draw it in a linear fashion, okay, let us draw this. Oryce, okay, the Oryce is a AT rich site. The specific location, which is AT rich. What does this AT rich means? See, if the Oryce, we have to break the two strands. I've taken the linear form. So if this is the Oryce, this is the specific point where the origin of replication taking place. We generally call it as Oryce. So it should be AT rich, means if it is AT, it is double bond. It is easily breakable. Okay, easily breaks. While C and G, it is difficult to break this bond. Why? Because this is triple bond. All right, it will be needing more and more energy to break C and G location, but where the A and T, adenine and thymines, are present, that site is easily breakable, due to which we can separate both the bonds, both the strands. All right, so we should see if where is the specific location in Oryce which is AT rich, so that we can separate the bonds. And when, just after that, after finding AT rich location, there is an enzyme called, I'll be writing about the enzymes here. Initiation. So the first enzyme that comes and bind to the Oryce is a DNA A and a protein. This is a protein. All right. So for example, this is Oryce. So the enzyme, the protein called DNA A, will come and bind to the Oryce region. Okay, DNA A, which is a protein, will come and bind to the Oryce. It will form to separate the bonds. What happens? It will form a tension, a negative supercoiling, a negative tension. It will give a negative tension to the strands of DNA, to the DNA, so that it can immediately get separated. So when the DNA A recognizes this site, the Oryce site, what happens? The DNA comes in the pressure, in the tension, and since if we see in the E. coli, it's a circular DNA, right? So what happens? In a circular DNA, there is no way out. There is no way out from where the tension can be released. So it will form Oryce, right? Oryce. So what does it do? It will do the supercoiling. The supercoiling the supercoiling of DNA happens. So, which is a negative part? It should not be supercoiled. The tension should be released and the two strands should be separated. Okay? But since it forms a supercoiled position, because there is a DNA A protein that is bind to this site. Alright? This is a DNA A protein which binds to this site, and there is no way out through which it can be released. So immediately there is another enzyme that should be uploaded to the system. That is another enzyme that is uploaded is a DNA B, which is known as helicase. Alright, the DNA B, that is a helicase, is uploaded in this procedure, and it is the primary protein which helps in the separation of the two strands. So it helps in the melting. So now comes DNA B, alright, to release this, tension, DNA B, that is a helicase, enzyme is uploaded here, and then what happens? It acts on the oryze and it will start melting the DNA. If we melt the DNA, the two strands will get separated. The melting of DNA strands happens. Alright. So now, after the DNA B, that is a helicase enzyme, is uploaded, you can see this area. This particular area, how is it looking like? Isn't it looking like this? Only this particular area, like this and like this, right? Right? How is it looking like? Like a replication fork. A fork-like structure, right? So what happens, a specific location called the oryze is the origin of replication, where a DNA A, that is a protein, recognizes the site and gets binded to it. But soon it binds itself to the oryze. It produces a tension, a pressure over the DNA. That is why it coils around. Okay, and to release that pressure or tension, what happens? The another enzyme called the DNA B, along with, which is not that important, but still I'm telling you, along with DNA C. All right, DNA C is uploaded. Actually, about this, you have to study in the higher classes. Still, I'll be explaining just an overview I'm giving about it. So, DNA C, which is a hexamer, both the enzymes, DNA B and DNA C, both are hexamers. So, I can make a diagram like this. Okay, hexamer. A hexamer unit, all right. And if we say a DNA C, okay, so this is a hexamer unit, all right. This is a DNA B, a helicase, and this is a DNA C, all right. The enzymes that are uploaded in the procedure of DNA replication to melt the DNA strands and get separated them. Okay, So when the DNA strand is melted, there is this structure looks like, this particular structure looks like this, which is known as a replication fork. In E. coli, since it is a circular DNA, there will be two replicating fork that will be present or that will be produced in the process. For example, if this is the melting of DNA, then what happens? There are two replicating forks present here. All right, in case of E. coli. So what happens when two of the strain, two replicating fork are present? The replication goes in the two direction, bidirection. While in linear DNA, what happens? one of the end is linear, so the tension releases from there. So it will be most of the time unidirectional. All right, but in particularly in case of E. coli, that is a prokaryote, it is a bidirectional. Bidirectional replication. Okay, here in E. coli, the two replicating forks are present, and simultaneously they'll be moving in the opposite direction, clockwise, anti-clockwise. And then what happens? For example, the two replicating fork, right? The two replicating fork, the bubble-like structure, the bubbles are formed here. So in a circular DNA, what happens? It's normally like this, not exactly like this. So in E. coli, what happens? It is a circular DNA. So when this fork, this particular fork, these two forks, this one and this one, one will move in the clockwise direction and anti-clockwise direction and clockwise direction. All right, what happens? They both will come and meet at a point, right? This point is known as a termination site, all right, where the replication ends and both the strands are separated and then produces their new strands. Each strands will produce their new replicas, all right. So termination site. So in the circular DNA, how it will be formed? In the circular DNA, for example, if this is a DNA of E. coli, then another one will be formed like this, right? So we have to nick it here, and then the two daughter progeny double helixes are produced. All right. So in case of two daughter progenies will be formed. All right. In case of circular DNA. So after forming the bubbles, what is the next enzyme that will take place? Just rubbing it out again. Okay. So there is another enzyme. For example, if this is a replicating fork, now I'm drawing only one replication fork. Okay, You just remember that in case of prokaryotes. Alright. So, this is a replicating fork. The another one is that side. The clockwise direction. Okay. And the anti-clockwise direction. And clockwise direction, two replicating forks are formed. So, I'm drawing here only one replicating fork. Alright. So, if one, the direction, how is it defined? 5 prime to 3 prime and 3 prime to 5 prime, right? So what happens? A helicase enzyme has come and bind it here. Alright. At first, the enzyme, the protein DNA A comes and then forms the supercoiling, right? And to avoid this, what happens? Another enzyme called the DNA helicase comes. What is this? This is a hexamer helicase, that is a DNA B plus DNA C has come. Okay, and bound here. All right. This direction, they have opened the direction. Now what if these two strands that are separated gets annealed, right? Re-annealed. What happens? So to inhibit the process of re-annealing means these are separated. If they get along together again, what will happen? The whole process will be ruined. So there is another enzyme called SSB. That is single stranded binding protein which will come and bind to this region. Okay, that means to each separated strand. Okay, for example, let us draw it like this. All right, what is this? The SSB protein will come and bind to each separated strands of DNA, and then because of this they will inhibit the re-annealing process, all right, which is very important. So here the initiation process has already started. Now coming to the elongation process, where the polymerization of nucleotides will be done. Like in English, with the 26 letters we make words or sentences, right? Here the backbone of DNA is made up of nucleotides, repeated number of nucleotides. All right, so to add those repeated number of nucleotides here, like the new replicas will be formed. These are the parent DNA which are being separated. Now they will form the DNA, their replicas. All right, this will be the daughter DNA I'm talking about. Two daughter DNA. Okay. The replicas of the parent DNA. All right, and how they are going to produce? They are already being separated by the action of DNA B helicase enzyme plus DNA C, and this DNA B utilizes ATP. Okay, of course, ATP, it utilizes the energy source by hydrolyzing it to the ADP. Okay, phosphorus group is released and then ATP is formed.
the energy that is required by the DNA B helicase enzyme to separate both the strands of DNA. So this is what is the initiation process of DNA replication. Here the initiation process ends, and now comes the elongation part, where these new DNA will be, DNA strands will be formed. That I'll be covering in the next video, and please subscribe my channel so that I can boost my energy, and if you will be liking my videos, I'll be making new videos for you. Thank you.